good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dr. Philip Phillips, and I'm the Associate Dean of the University Honors College. I'm pleased to welcome you to our Honors Lecture Series. We have recently completed all of our lectures dealing with rhetoric and contemporary culture, and today we have a special guest speaker. But before I introduce our special guest speaker, I'd like to acknowledge our own Dean, John Vile, who is with us, and I would like to introduce two visitors we have, Carolyn and Don Midget, who are visiting today. Don Midget is one of the members of our Board of Visitors here at MTSU, and both of them are big supporters of the university and especially of the University Honors College. So we're glad that you're here today, and we're glad that you could attend this lecture. It's always a pleasure for me to welcome and introduce Dr. Eric Klumpa. Dr. Klumpa and I started at MTSU in the same year, in 1999. We're in completely different fields, and that's why he's here today, and that's why the dean and I invited him. Not only is he a member of our Honors College faculty, but he's also one of our Buchanan professors. He has taught for many years the seminar on exploring the universe. He has also been kind enough to accept our invitations when we have read about some amazing new discovery in science that neither one of us can figure out. But we figured that the topic is important enough that, you know, we bring in somebody who can explain very difficult and complex things to a multidisciplinary audience. And so that is the case today. There are many things that I could say about Dr. Klumpa, but I think he's well known to many of you already. And at this time, please join me in welcoming him.
Yeah, I'm always pleasantly surprised when there's an email from you guys inviting me over. This is one of my favorite things to do. I love the Honors College. I love what happens over here. And to be a part of your day means something to me. Just a really quick story about the fellowships. I want to follow up on that. My daughter was a finalist for both the Marshall and the Churchill, but she was finishing her English degree at Oxford at the time. But those are two scholarships that would allow her to study in England. She made it to the place where they had to do their face-to-face interviews. So she had to fly to the United States twice to interview for a scholarship so she could study in England. So that's a pretty big deal, I guess. Anyway, but I do encourage you. I totally agree about getting your name out there, just trying and get these scholarships. It just helps. It helps with your future. And it may even help you decide what you want to do with your life. It's a good thing. But thanks again. Yeah, I'm an astronomer. We're going to talk about the TRAPPIST-1 planets. I've nicknamed it Earth's Seven Sisters because in some ways it sounds like we're discovering planets that have a lot in common with planet Earth. You are living at a very, very exciting time, astronomically speaking. It's at a point where I think a major astronomical discovery is being made every week. Okay? The technology that we now have available to us, like this discovery here, this could not have been done 10 years ago. It probably couldn't have been done 3 years ago. We're getting to a place where the sensitivity of our equipment is progressing to a level where we're starting to see things that prior generations could never have seen. So it's very, very exciting to be able to share this with you. I'm going to start, and you're going to say, where is this going? that's kind of a secret, but kind of not. But this is a terrific children's book. It's called You Can Be Anything by Charles Schulz, the Peanuts author. A quote on page one is, just like Snoopy, what you can achieve is limited only by your imagination. You can be anything. There was a quote I read written by in an astronomy article. It hasn't yet been accepted for publication. It was being submitted by two Harvard professors, and I encountered an astronomical statement that read to me just like this. My thoughts were, wow, well, in this case, this statement, it encourages children to think big when contemplating their future. Because when you're dealing with a child, you're dealing with somebody who has all this potential. the child may not even know what he or she is good at yet. The parents don't know. So you kind of are very optimistic. You're very encouraging. You're very empowering when you raise your children. I know with our kids, we were always exposing them to new things. Just try whatever you can. We discovered very quickly with my son, for example, in spite of how much he loved basketball, it became obvious that my son, he's not going to be limited. He's only been limited by his imagination. He can do anything but basketball. I mean, we knew that was off the list because he got to a place where the other boys were just getting so much better, so much faster, and he realized his future was going to be in thinking and not so much in sports. Now he's actually an employed engineer, and we're very proud of him. I'm sure that all of us have said this. I know I'm a parent. I'm sure my parents have things similar to me, and this is how we inspire people. But think about this. What if your college advisor said it to you? Would you go like, whoa, that's cool. I'm going to be a doctor. I got a 2.0 GPA, but I'm going to be a doctor. You know, you realize. And so the point I'm trying to make when I tie this in at the end of my talk is this. It's an okay adult's book because it's not literally anything anymore, okay? For adults, this sort of expression seems empowering, but only when you don't think about it, okay? And if you believe it, you've bought into a myth that is certain to disappoint, okay? But what we could do is, how about motivating people to do something important? Like maybe go and deal with in Africa with AIDS, you know, HIV, something. That sounds important to me. Or how about something good? Actually, you get check mark in both of them now. But something good, you know, help build a home or something, or do something stretching. This is something we can all do that's actually quite realistic and not quite as not quite as much of a stretch as that sentence. You know, something that stretches you. Today, let's say you can run a 10-minute mile, make it a goal to be able to run a 9.5-minute mile. That would be stretching. Or I'm going to take 15 units instead of 12 units. You know, things like that. Those are all good. And so what I'm saying is I would prefer quotes that are simultaneously true as well as inspiring. So we're going to talk about a quote that I read in a journal, or at least in a submission for a journal. And it ties in very closely with what we're doing here. Okay. Trappist, what is that? Well, believe it or not, in this context, it's not a word. It's an acronym. And the TRA, T is right here, T-R-A, okay, P, skip that word, P, grab that I before it gets away. No, yeah, grab that I before it gets away, S-T, Trappist. No, it's not a forced acronym. That's exactly what it is. But it's transiting is a process. For example, this has happened for people who live on Earth. When we look at the sun, there are certain times, dates, and years where Venus, which is an inner planet, as it goes around the sun, will actually pass between the sun and the Earth. And you see this little black dot going by, okay? And we say it's transiting. So when a planet is transiting, it's actually passing, and it's sort of revealing itself to us as a silhouette. Now, in the case of an eclipse, like August 21st, 2017, be there. Any student of mine has to come. And remember, you're supposed to bring your children. But if you don't have children, you got to bring your stuffed animals. And I will tell them how smart you are and that you are my favorite student. That is true. Every student I've had since I've been here, I said, when you come back on that day, bring your children, and I will brag to your children how smart you were. And they go, we're only 18. I said, OK, bring your stuffed animals. But see, in that case, if the moon were tiny, it would look like it was transiting the sun. But because it's so big, it actually eclipses the sun because it's the same size. It's that idea. And so what this telescope does is it looks for transiting planets. And it's located south of the equator, hence the modifier south. And this is in Chile, South America. Here's the family portrait. Oh, look at those guys. They're almost, you can tell they're in the same family. I mean, they're all round. They're all kind of shiny on the left side. You see that? TRAPPIST-1, okay, there's all kinds of catalogs in astronomy. The TRAPPIST catalog now is any object that was discovered by the telescope that's inside this observatory. And TRAPPIST-1 is actually the proper name for this star. And then you start to label the planets alphabetically. And for some reason, in tradition, we don't use the letter A. So the first one is B. And they're done in the order that they were discovered. Okay, now they were all kind of discovered as a group, so at that case you just go inside out. Okay, they were kind of discovered as a group, so you can't say we did this one first, and so forth, and there they are. Okay, Now, we have to begin our conversation with what is an Earth-like planet. And this has some bearing on my reference to the Charles Schulz book. Because some of us will come up with a definition that represents an Earth-like planet that was actually pretty much standard fare 50 years ago. So you would say some definitions for what constitutes an Earth-like planet when the field of research was an infant or a young child, so to speak, to push the metaphor to its limits. Okay, but now we're looking at a field of research that's 50 years old. That same sentence can't work anymore. We'll see what that is. But I would like to ask a few people, I won't, but I would like to, what is your definition for an Earth-like planet? And in some ways, that'll reveal something about you. Okay, if you like being outside, you'll probably talk about green grass, it's got to have beautiful mountains, and that kind of a thing. So what is an Earth-like planet? And that sort of be very revealing, and it'd make a great conversation starter. But within the context of exoplanet searches, you need to know what are we capable of doing with exoplanet searches. And we can identify three things, and now a fourth thing has come online. Let me share those with you. One of the things we know when we look at exoplanets is we can identify the star that's involved. In this example, it would be, what kind of star is TRAPPIST-1? Okay, the star. We can describe what kind of a planet are we looking at? Right now, all exoplanets fit into one of three categories. It's either super Earth, it's either hot Jupiter, or it's called a gas giant. And what we're hoping for is Earth-like, which is sort of a new category, but the smaller the planet, the more advanced your technology has to be. Okay, so to be Earth-like, it has to be the right size, because super Earths are actually bigger than Earth. The third thing that we've traditionally been able to identify to say if it's an Earth-like planet is, what's the spacing between that star and that planet? Are they really close? Whoa, that sounds like a hot place to live. Are they really far away? Oh, I hope you guys brought your parka, okay? But anyway, the just right distance. And when you marry those things together, you begin to talk about what is one of the most critical media that we see in life as we understand it, liquid water. How do those three things come to bear on whether a planet could or could not have liquid water? Okay, but we can measure this, the size of the planet, we can measure the type of star, we can measure the distance between the two. But now we're coming online with even the chemical composition of the atmosphere, and this comes into play as I'll explain when we go forward. Why does the atmosphere even matter? How would you measure the chemical composition of the star? Well, as it's transiting, light will pass through the atmosphere. Because when you look at the star, it's a circle, but there's a fuzzy rim called atmosphere. Light comes through it, you can see what's being absorbed. Okay, that kind of a thing. And you're looking for gases that you would normally associate with a planet that would be habitable or Earth-like. Okay, we're going to mention this. This was discovered either a week ago or 2 weeks ago, which has been called by some the closest thing to an Earth-like planet with an atmosphere. And we're going to tie that in at the very end. It wasn't part of my original talk, but you can't let these things go. You know, it popped up, let's talk about it. So let's go for it. All right, what is an Earth-like planet? Okay, from the observations that we make, we typically are looking for the probability that you could have liquid water. This picture is meant to illustrate what I would call a stable water cycle. I would say a planet has a stable water cycle when water exists in all three phases simultaneously. Okay. If it gets out of balance, which is to say a planet that's too cold, notice that the gaseous phase and even the liquid phase could disappear. If it gets too hot, the solid phase and the liquid phase could disappear. But when you have this balance, you know, between solid, that's snow, liquid, vapor, okay, transpiration's not in this, but that's the process by which plants give up vapor just because they're absorbing it from the ground and that sort of thing. And you get this stable water cycle. And what you notice is water never really leaves the planet. To within a few percentage points, the amount of water there, it just lingers. It goes up, it comes down. It goes up, it comes down. And you get a stable water cycle, and you get it in the liquid state. Water is regarded as the best medium to support biochemical reactions. So this is based on the way biologists would describe life and what life needs to survive. And I guess in some sense, you could say it is biased heavily towards life as we understand it. All right? And it's considered to be necessary, but not sufficient. Let me explain this to you, because back in the 50s, you almost got the impression when you read articles, excuse me, not the 50s, 50 years ago, but in the 60s, you almost got the impression when you're reading these articles that water is not only necessary, it is sufficient. See, that's an article when you read and it says water has been discovered, it's a high likelihood it has life there. Notice the existence of water is necessary and sufficient to draw a conclusion that life could be there. If you said, for example, oh, there's a high probability that water could exist on this planet, and if other things fell into place appropriately, then it could also be a good place for life. Notice now it's no longer necessary and sufficient. It's necessary but not sufficient. But you kind of get that impression sometimes. And like I said, headlines can lead folks to conclude that scientists think that water is both necessary and sufficient. But that's okay. People are trying to communicate discoveries. Not every journalist has a degree in science. And sometimes our enthusiasm to get people excited, sometimes we'll use flashy headlines. But I'm willing to give a lot of margin and freedom in that. So here's a 50-year-old definition. The first astronomers to quantify life support parameters were Frank Drake of the Drake Equation, if you've heard of it, and there it is. Okay, Carl Sagan, okay, we all know who he was, and he's an amazing man. I've had the opportunity to work sort of with him. He was on the Viking Project when I was working on the Viking Project in the 70s. It was the mission to Mars. It was the first life experiment we ever did on planet Mars. He was a part of that. He was a Cornell professor, planetary astronomer. And then Yusuf Shklovsky, which is sort of the Russian equivalent of this gentleman here. Okay, and these guys pretty much started this whole idea, this whole new branch of science, which I guess has grown into astrobiology. In 66, they indicated that all that was needed was to have the right type of star with the right planet orbiting at just the right distance, those three things I just mentioned to you. Okay, but we're living at a time where we now know that it's a little more subtle than that, a little more subtle. And that's one of the, I guess, the hard things about being in a field is the amount of work you have to do to stay caught up. But this is now known as the habitable zone. I added this word, I put it in brackets like that, because what's been called the habitable zone technically is now just the water habitable zone, because we are now realizing there's at least six or seven other types of habitable zones. And they all have to be in the Goldilocks sweet spot simultaneously for a long duration of time, okay? And so when you hear habitable zone, you understand? That's what it really means is the habitable zone, as it was defined by them, was the zone where water can persist as a liquid. It has nothing to do with whether life exists or not. You see that? But the word habitable seems to imply that people would be comfortable there. You see? So it's kind of a bit of a misnomer, but that's what it's been known, and now, and it still reads that way today. Habitable zone needs to have the modifier water put in front of it. I have a bad habit of injecting Volkswagen buses into all my talks. Okay, am I trying to push it here? Yes, absolutely. But notice the habitable zone, if you're going to live in there, don't park over here. Okay? Are we good on that one? Don't do it. All right. Okay. Here's another picture that helps us to understand the water habitable zone. The star is a source of heat. It makes things warm. We need that. Okay? Here are planets. They've given us three examples. One that's in the red, the green, and the blue. There's two arrows. The red one represents the distance between the planet and the star, and the blue one represents the thickness of that region that's the so-called sweet spot. So if you think about it, Goldilocks, you go, this location's too hot. This location's too cold. This one's just right, okay? And the just right zone has thickness. It has thickness. Okay, here we go. This illustrates the same thing, but what it's done is instead of giving us a generic star, it says, what if the star was hotter than the sun? What if the star was the same temperature as the sun? What if the star was colder than the sun? If it's colder, does it make sense to you? You have to be closer, okay? You've been out backpacking, you're freezing, whatever you're doing, and there's a fire over there, but it's like this big. You're going to get right on top of it, aren't you, okay? But if it's a blaze, I had some friends that made such a huge campfire when they're out camping that the fog disappeared on this mountaintop, and they bragged about how they changed the weather. I said, dude, I wish I was there. Okay, all right. But what's going on here is if this star is very luminous, very bright, then the too close, you know, the inner edge of where you can have liquid water will be set off a bit. But then the range where you can move and still have liquid water seems to be much larger. So these arrows tend to grow with increasing temperature and get smaller with decreasing. And the coolest star, and this does not mean that the star wears sunglasses indoors. I know it sounds like that, okay? The coolest star is the one that has the lowest temperature. And notice that the habitable zone for water is extremely tiny and extremely thin. It's both of those, okay? Oh, yes, that means too hot. That's a Volkswagen bus that's been abandoned in the desert. That's one that's been abandoned in the snow, and that one's just right. Well, actually, it's kind of abandoned in shallow water. All right, I don't know if there's a take-home point from that, but memorize this star type. Memorize begins with M. Astronomers will call them M dwarfs. M dwarfs are these types of stars, M dwarfs, okay? And memorize the name, well, M. All right, the best Earth 2.0 to date. This is my opinion of the best Earth 2.0 to date. This is a very busy diagram, and I apologize, but for you, suffice to say that this green region represents the habitable zone for planets, okay? All right, in this zone, you're dealing with sort of that sweet spot, okay? And E stands for Earth. Okay, that's the marker I'm going to use to designate this best, what I call Earth 2.0. Look at that, right next door. That's kind of cool. It is within the habitable zone of its host star. The host star actually is quite similar to the Sun. So it's the right star in distance. It's roughly the same size as Earth. It's 90% of the mass and probably about 95% of the radius. That's starting to sound pretty good. So it's the right planet. And preliminary measurements on its atmosphere indicate at the upper levels of its atmosphere, the temperatures are comparable to what you would see on Earth. It's promising. Awesome or cool. I just described Venus. I just described Venus. Do you now understand why this is not an easy science to pursue? I literally just described Venus because we now know that unless you're really knowledgeable about the structure of the atmosphere, we know that as you go deeper down to the surface of Venus, it does get hotter, carbon dioxide rich, and you can melt lead. I don't see a lot of biological, you know, biochemical reactions taking place at a temperature where lead would melt. So, there you go. So how are the TRAPPIST planets discovered? That was a little bit of background. Here's the side view. And notice the planets, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, but they showed two of them transiting. That's what a transit looks like if you could generate a focused image of the star, which we cannot do. It's too far away. But notice that some light has been subtracted. If you were to try to record the brightness of that teeny tiny dot that I can see in my camera, the brightness took a little dip. And it does it in a very, very periodic way. Whoa, that means something's blocking it in a periodic way, which is very much like a planet that is orbiting. This is a simulation that I put here. And here we go. Let's see. This is a picture of what I just showed you. You see that? And all these little knobs and things allow us to change the geometry. This represents the brightness, okay? This represents the star totally unblocked by a planet. And as the planet progresses across the face of the star, it gradually dims until the planet itself is fully inside the circle of light, and then it comes across, and this is as it's starting to move away. What I can do is I can play around with it just a little bit. We don't want to take too much time here. Let me see if I can find that little place that allows me to adjust the... There it is. There's the phase. Okay, it's a shame it's at the bottom, but we can work with this. Let me see what I can do. Maybe not. All right. Let me go back up just a tad. Okay, I'll move the phase. Look at the picture on the left as I play with the so-called phase of the orbit. You see that? Notice that when the planet is off to the side, we get the full brightness right there. You see that? And something interesting just happened, probably because I pressed the clicker. All right. Oh, wait. The phase is down here. My mistake. All right. But notice that as it's crossing the edge of the star, we start to see a dip. When it's fully inside that circle, notice that it flattens out again, and then as it pops out the other side, it does it in reverse. And there's various ways in which the planet can cross. What if the planetary orbit was at an inclination? Or what if it was highly elliptic? Or what if it had a partner, other planets around it? All these things come to play. And a lot of that can be determined by looking at the brightness of that star and how it changes over time. This is an actual data set that was published December 11th, 2015. Notice, as it turns out, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, the family portrait, only C, E, and F were discovered by TRAPPIST. The others was discovered. The other four were discovered by a follow-up study done by a space-based infrared telescope called Spitzer, because that's the last name of an infrared astronomer who's very famous. What they're showing is, notice, when all the planets are not covering the face, that would represent this. At this location in time, two have just crept in. So you see a steep drop. When the third one creeps in, it drops again. You see that? And then this one leaves, and then that one leaves, and then that one leaves, as you can see, and it's going to go one, two, three. So there's three planets there. You see that? And you kind of can see, notice the latitude with which it crosses the planet. That can be discerned from the data, believe it or not. And you're looking at periodicity. And what you do is you generate a computerized model. I've done this same model, by the way. I had a student do this work for me. And we did some data that I got off a website. But you can actually say, what sort of pattern? You just keep guessing at reasonable guesses for the pattern for how the planets orbit. And when you recreate it, this is the computerized recreation on top of the data that were actually observed. That's a pretty robust fit. And I go, wow, that is way cool. And so they said, we just discovered three planets. Okay, but the Spitzer infrared telescope said, hey, I'm going to check that out. They found four more. And now the whole family is B, C, D, E, F, G, and H. And there you go. That's what you're looking for. You're looking for things that are in silhouette. Okay. All right, quick description now. This is TRAPPIST-1. It's very, very cold, okay? It's not very warm. I mean, compared to you and me, it is. It'd burn your hand. Don't touch it. If you touch it, don't have your parents call me. I told you not to do it. All right? But here you go. But you compare how big it is to how big the sun is. You have to sort of complete this in your mind, how big that circle is. And when you look at Jupiter, you realize, oh, look, it's actually more Jupiter-sized. Okay? And if these planets are in the habitable zone, the fact that they're so close in this picture is meant to communicate it's not nearly as hot as, say, the sun would be. This is a logarithmic scale, so it's everything to do with factors of 10. That's a 1, that's a 10, that's 100. What you notice is the orbital period of that star, of that planet around this star, that's 1 day, 2 days. It orbits once every 2.5 days or so. You know, just imagine if you lived there. You'd be having like your 5,000th birthday or something. It's like, I mean, everybody has, you know, everybody, which day were you born on? It's like, you know, January 1st and January 2nd. Then it goes back to January 1st again. Okay? We're all the same birthdays. All right? I know. That would be about, I think I'd like that. Now the cake thing would catch up to me after a while. But notice this one's more like around 20. It goes 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, and then 100, 200. And you get the impression it's a very compact system. It's a very, very compact system. Things are happening very fast. But the proximity is required to get the warmth you need. Okay? With the sun, notice we're way out here. Look at that. Let's see. It'd be right about there. Let's see. It's 100, 200, 300. What is that? 350? I can't remember what it is. Oh, 365. Yeah, okay. It fits. All right. TRAPPIST is, it turns out, is an M dwarf. That's it. That's what it is. It would be down here on this HR diagram. Without getting into a lot of detail, it illustrates how stars that we understand, cold ones, medium ones, warmer, and really hot stars behave. This is an indicator of temperature. This is an indicator of brightness. But basically, these are the cold ones because cold is on the right. The sun is kind of an intermediate, and then these are blue hot. Blue is the hottest color. And then as you work your way up, okay? So it shows you where the sun is and where TRAPPIST is. Okay? And yes, stars come in colors. Yeah, there you go. All right. Yes, there you go. Okay, very good. All right, so why are M dwarfs important? This is a very valuable piece of information I'm about to share with you. It turns out that if you did some sort of a pie chart that illustrates how the stars break down, 70% of the stars in the sky fit right over here. It's because they're so small. Just think about it. If you had a pizza, you can make 100 small pieces, but you can only make 2 really big pieces. So there's only going to be 2 big stars in the pizza universe, but there could be hundreds of small stars in the pizza universe. Why are there so many? Because they're small. But because they're small, they're not very hot, okay? And they're way over there, all right? So it makes up the majority. What this tells you is if there's a problem with M dwarfs, you have eliminated 70% of the stars as potential habitable sites. That's what you've done. Nobody wants that kind of bad news. I don't want to hear that. Do you want to hear that? I don't think you want to hear that. No, we don't want to hear that. All right? But there's the breakdown. You see the big ones are makes the small sliver. And we're in that category right there for the sun. Oh, and yes, they are the most popular color. All right. Okay. Here's a quote. Okay. The discovery, in referring to TRAPPIST-1, the discovery sets a new record for the greatest number of habitable zone planets found around a single star outside our solar system. That is the major take-home point, in my opinion, for the discovery. We have just raised the bar. We have raised the bar of discovery. We now have a way. We discovered 7 planets, all Earth-sized, within the so-called habitable zone. That's huge. Never been done before. 5 years ago, I would have told you the technology couldn't handle it. That's why I would have told you. I'm glad you didn't invite me, by the way. I don't want to be the bearer of bad news. I'm glad I'm here now. So thank you for waiting 5 years to invite me. All right.
We read that same quote. That's why I wrote to you. Why I invited you.
Yeah. Well, thank you for that. Thank you, great minds. Actually, your mind is slightly greater because you're almost in charge of the Honors College, and I'm still a grunt. And we've been here the same amount of time. I need. So there you go. Okay. Anyway. But all of these 7 planets, this is a NASA quote, all of these 7 planets could have liquid water, key to life as we understand it, under the right atmospheric conditions. I'm so glad they put that there, because that's what's changed the game. That's what's changed the game, is that we now understand this. If you ignore atmosphere, Venus is almost a twin to the Earth. Did you know that? On the terms that we've defined. But we all know it's not. I mean, anyway, remember that crazy uncle from Venus that came for Thanksgiving? See? Okay, anyway. I know. All right. But the chances are highest within the 3 in the habitable zone. So that's a very, very good quote. Here's another one. The planets circle tightly around a dim dwarf star called TRAPPIST-1, barely the size of Jupiter. Very cool. 3 are in the so-called habitable zone, the area around a star where water and possibly life might exist. This is a very important word, but sometimes we get the impression that it's necessary and sufficient, but that represents the fact that they recognize that's just one piece in the habitable puzzle. The others are right on the doorstep, okay? CBS New York. This is the first time astronomers have discovered so many terrestrial planets orbiting a single star, and this new system could be the best target in the galaxy to search for extraterrestrial life. That one caught my eye, because this is consistent if you think the way people thought 50 years ago. Okay, that's what I'm saying. So this is a bit of an exciting thing to read, but unfortunately, science has progressed. What I've done here is I did this March 23rd, 2017. I went to a website called exoplanet.eu, and I downloaded all the known data for every exoplanet that's ever been discovered as of a month ago. Okay, that's all of them. You see data clusters, super Earths, hot Jupiters, gas giants. Those are the 3 categories. TRAPPIST is going to push us down here. We're now, notice the reason that there's so many of those isn't because there's a lot of them in space, there is, but it's selection effects. Those are the ones that are easiest to see. That's why we know so many of them. They're the easiest ones to see. It's like walking into a room. You're going to know where all the loud people are because they talk loudly. Okay? So there you go. This line, those 2 lines intersect with the Earth. This represents 1 astronomical unit, the distance between us and the sun, and this represents 1 mass, the mass of the Earth. So the Earth is located there. So to discover a planet that's actually like Earth is very challenging. We don't see a lot of data in that area. Now this one is roughly the right size, as are these. So these are all Earth size. That's one even smaller still. Okay, that represents Venus. As you can see, you notice how close it is. And if you didn't know what kind of star it was, you'd swear they were twins. But we know what kind of star, what kind of atmosphere it had, you would swear they were twins. Okay? This represents Mars. So that's a Mars-sized planet. Okay? And because the inner edge of our habitable zone starts with Venus and it ends with Mars, it's kind of on the hairy edge, then this box kind of represents, for a star like the Sun, this is that Goldilocks zone for a star like the Sun. But TRAPPIST isn't like the Sun. It's colder. So we'd expect this to shift to the left, but not drop down, because if it Earth-sized is this level. But we'd expect something over here. And sure enough, we know the discovery puts it right there. So it's right on. So to be in the water habitable zone, clearly TRAPPIST-1 is, but that's where it would be on that plot. And as you can see, this is a sparsely populated region in our knowledge of how, in terms of our exploration for planets. So we'll start to see this population increasing. We'll be adding data points here all the time. Here's the system. Notice, because it's so small and compact, you take this picture, too hot, just right, too cold. You take this, you've got to squish all of that down into here. So what we're saying is the entire TRAPPIST system would be way, way inside Mercury's orbit on our planet. So you've got, this is sort of a long and this is sort of a small. We're comparing the two types of habitable zones right there. Yes, that's a hand-sized V-dub, and that's an oversized one. So it can be small or big. There you go. Okay, now, and that is the most habitable Volkswagen I've ever seen. I think I could live in there for like, a year. But let's talk about other types of habitable zones now. I think a lot of us say, yes, I'm actually following what you're saying. And that's kind of a neat thing. I'm actually understanding this guy, and he's not putting me to sleep. So I'm very happy about that. There's something called the continuously habitable zone. And that comes into play when you recognize that stars are not this constant, steady flame burning with a constant temperature throughout its life. Stars are dynamic. They change. And when the Sun formed, we think that it had about, 98% of its current luminosity or wattage, its output of energy. But then it dropped down when it was about a billion years old. It dropped down, and it's hard to climb back up again. And that has to do with the way a star, as it manufactures energy, settles down into some sort of a stable configuration, the core, and so forth. But what that tells you is that, that conditions on the surface of the Earth, as we understand them, it's apparent from the fossil record that I think the surface of the Earth was comfortable for a long, long time, billions of years. I think the oldest fossil that I'm aware of is like a billion years after Earth had formed or something. It's been comfortable, but notice it's been comfortable as the output of the Sun has been changing. And something that the Earth has experienced that neither Venus nor Mars experienced, we are currently in our third atmosphere. Our atmosphere has adapted in such a way to counterbalance what the Sun is doing. The first atmosphere of Earth was probably rich in methane, ammonia, and water, which is what you see in the gas giants. They have a lot of gravity. Okay, a lot of those gases dissipated into space, and some of them were broken down because the ultraviolet radiation from the Sun is sufficient to break down the molecular bonds. Then we went into kind of a carbon dioxide-rich atmosphere. That was a result of volcanism. Volcanoes going off all the time. We got a lot of nitrogen and a lot of CO2. And then when you have things like photosynthesis, for example, CO2 starts to get converted into oxygen. So we're in oxygen-nitrogen-rich atmosphere right now. But what you notice, when the Sun was cold, we had a blanket of carbon dioxide. Now that we're warm, we have a transparent atmosphere. And so for us, to say that we're typical, we're pretty much saying now, Earth-like seems to mean that you have to have an atmosphere that changes as your host star changes. You have to change together. All right? But a continuously habitable zone would say, okay, when the star first formed, the habitable zone is going to be close. And as it matures, the habitable zone moves out. So the purple habitable zone is when the star is young, the green one when it's old, and the area that they overlap is narrower than the so-called habitable zone. So a term like continuously habitable zone came to bear. Notice Mars is in the habitable zone, but not the continuous one. And Venus is in the habitable zone, but not the continuous one. You see, we're being more selective by saying it has to be just right for a long time. And the way it works isn't because it's simply the geometry of the distance between the sun and the planet, but the planet itself has to have an atmosphere that is adapting and being modified in a way that works. CHZs are smaller than HZs. So we've kind of narrowed it down. Do we know if TRAPPIST-1, if those planets are in the continuously habitable zone? Well, it's looking like no. Okay, but I'll leave that for later. And continuous habitable zones are taken into account without full knowledge of the actual chemicals that are contained in the atmosphere. Okay, the initial atmosphere that the planet had. If Earth started out with a more transparent atmosphere, then our continuously habitable zone would have started way out here. Okay, or it could have been much closer. So it seems that our continuous habitable zone isn't directly translatable to other planets unless we know that they started out with a similar atmosphere as Earth started out with. Evolving habitable zones, okay, because Earth has sustained life for 3.8 billion years in spite of the sun's increasing its brightness by at least 18%, some conclude that, oh, that sounds like it's very relaxed kind of a thing. You can have as much as plus or minus 9%. You know, you can have an 8% variation, and everything would be very, very fine. The problem with that is, at any given time, the habitable zone for a planet is actually quite narrow. And we know this from people who take, a lot of people make it their job to help us understand how, you know, we live in a high-tech society. High-tech society produces high-tech pollution. High-tech pollution can actually, if enough countries are doing it, can alter the way weather works on planet Earth. And we're worried about that, correct? Okay, but we know that, you know, if we were to change Earth's position right now, if we could change Earth's position relative to the sun by 1%, we could generate either a runaway greenhouse effect or a runaway freeze-up, snowball Earth scenario, they call it. You could do that. That's 1%. So apparently the latitude isn't quite as flexible as some would lead us to conclude. We are unique, and this is the key thing. We are unique. Compare us to Mars, compare us to Venus. They have their second atmospheres. They have not transitioned to the third. We're in the third. And I think the reason it may have something to do with the fact that we have such, the amount of ocean water we have relative to the amount of continents is very large, okay? Because water is a great way to get rid of CO2 out of your atmosphere. It ends up going into the rocks at the bottom of the ocean. A lot of the CO2 that we had, our primordial CO2, is probably in the rocks at the bottom of the oceans right now, okay? There's a reaction that turns silicates into carbonates when you use carbon dioxide. It's called the Urey reaction. That's the same Urey from the Urey-Miller experiment, in case you're curious. Okay, so we are kind of unique in that way. So people are going, whoa. It's not just the distance between the star. I have 5 minutes. I'm in trouble. Okay, let's go to the back. Let's go to the end. Okay, but it was 2003 paper. All right, here's an interesting one really quickly. The habitable zone is listed here. And notice for M dwarfs, we're in this region here, okay? The tidal lock radius. Any planet that is to the left of this line has been despun. It doesn't spin. Consider a cookout where you have whatever is on the fire and the guy isn't turning the spit, okay? You don't get even warming. You don't get even cooking. Notice, I'm going really fast now, okay? All M stars, the habitable zone is on the left side of that line. They're all despun. All the TRAPPIST planets are despun. They don't spin. Can we detect spin yet? No, we cannot. That's why we don't talk about it. We don't know that they're doing that. And that's where it is. And we're not going to simulate it because it takes up too much time. And yeah, we had different Volkswagens. OK, good. Tidal habitable zones. Another source of energy is because tidal forces, which is a way that the central star can stretch. Yeah, I had the stretch Volkswagen and the shrunk one. Tidal forces can stretch and shrink planets as they go around the sun. That can actually take heat. They can actually generate heat in the crust of the planet. Okay, so there's a lot of tidal heating, which is to say the planets here are actually much hotter than they would be from the star alone. They're actually hotter. What does that do? Well, it now pushes the habitable zone out because it's sun plus tidal heating. Okay, and I think we're going to leave it at that. I think you get it. And the paper that I was reading came out in 2009. All right, UV habitable zones. All right, this was done in China. It turns out UV radiation is really, really important. Let me just jump to the bottom line. I think you can handle this. Okay, the paper was published in 2010. Okay, what we're saying is stars down here, because they're so red, don't produce a lot of UV. Stars up here produce way too much UV. And what you've got here are stars that have, like I said, we're kind of in the middle, so it's kind of the just right zone. But let's summarize what the scholars said here. Ultraviolet radiation is a double-edged sword to life. If it is too strong, the terrestrial biological systems will be damaged. And if it's too weak, the synthesis of many biochemical compounds cannot occur. Okay? And what you're discovering is, for host stars with effective temperatures lower than 4,600 Kelvin, which is the M dwarfs, the ultraviolet habitable zones are closer than the water. So you've got two necessary habitable zones that don't even overlap. They don't even overlap. So you can't have an intersection between those two sets. All right, let's keep going. In spite of their ubiquity, M-class stars are really terrible locations. Unfortunately, there they are, M. Okay, like our moon, Mercury, and Galilean satellites, all seven have been despun. No liquid water is possible in a despun planet because you have a hot side and a cold side. No magnetic field either. It's the spin that produces the magnetic field, which protects you from the radiation from the star. They don't spin. They don't have magnetic fields. They're getting hammered by solar wind particles, which are things like, it's just really hard radiation. And this X-ray telescope actually observed the TRAPPIST system in a follow-up, and they concluded that they've already been zapped with it's an X-ray telescope. It's the X-ray intensities are enough to have already destroyed their atmospheres anyway. So putting all the eggs in the Earth-like basket in the so-called water habitable zone is a really 50-year-old thinking. And there's the basket that we don't want to put the eggs in. Okay. And it turns out that none of the seven are a better physical match to Earth than Venus is. We can't talk about this because I have less than a few minutes. But anyway, sorry about that. But there it is. We found an atmosphere. Let's see. The speed of the winds, the color of its sunsets. That's another way to determine the atmosphere. Let's see. All right. So here we go. But that planet, there's a planet that's been discovered. It's been described as a really good place. It has an atmosphere. Maybe life is there. It received 19 times more stellar radiation than the Earth. The temperature is estimated to be 500 Fahrenheit. The planet is estimated to be hotter than Venus. It's possible that one side of the planet is cooler because it's presumed to be tidally locked. M-class stars, the planets are all tidally locked. And so forth and so forth. And here we go. Those are the three TRAPPISTs, and there's Venus. Look at this. That's 8% off in size, 4% off, 13% off, only 5%. But this one is the closer match. It's off by 4% to the Earth. We're off by 5 in Venus. But notice, 82% represents the mass. That's a lightweight. So it doesn't have a very strong gravitational pull to hold down an atmosphere. And so here we go. The field. I'm way over time, and I have to apologize. So what is the quote that I want? Oh, this one right here. These two guys from Harvard have put forward a paper. It has not been accepted. It's in review. It is now well known that there exist 10 billion habitable planets in the Milky Way, many of which orbit M dwarfs. And I was stunned. I go, that would have been an awesome thing to say when this field was just getting started, inspiring young minds to get into this field of research. But I was greatly grateful when, anyway, we're not going to bag on Harvard right now, okay? So we'll let this go. Okay. Okay, this is a NASA quote, and I want to quote this because I used to work for them. Red dwarfs, also called M dwarf to astronomers, have a number of complications. M dwarfs flare frequently. They actually have more solar storms or stellar storms than the Earth than the Sun does. They flare frequently and can emit a high energy radiation that can batter the planet's atmospheres. It's already been established. On top of that, when M dwarfs are young, they are much brighter during a period called the pre-main sequence. What this means is that planets currently in the habitable zone of M dwarfs were actually interior to the habitable zone during the long pre-main sequence phase and can now be desiccated and potentially Venus-like despite being in the habitable zone today. I go, oh, all right, finally, somebody. And gratefully, it's a company I used to work for, NASA. And so here we go. So astronomy has matured. Harvard's statement seems empowering only if you don't think about it. And if you do believe it, you bought into a myth that is certain to disappoint. And I like the NASA quote because it's simultaneously true as inspiring. Growing up, as all we know, can be a mite painful. Yes, your letter from Hogwarts is not going to come. I don't care how long you wait. So growing up is hard. All right, I'm done.